Welcome back, BIS2B students. In this video, we are going to orient you to the Lab 4 spreadsheet and show you how to do a t-test. In Lab 3, we collected data, but we didn't do a very sophisticated analysis with it. For this lab, we want you to really look at the data like a scientist would. To do that, we're going to look at the spreadsheet together. As part of Lab 4, you should have a spreadsheet that looks something like this. It could have more or fewer data points, so this sheet is just an example. The top row labels each column with the treatment, morph, and component of fitness. Remember that we had two different morphs of plants, purple and white. In addition, we had three components of fitness that are acting as our proxies of reproductive success. This column here just shows each person who entered their data. The specific person isn't important, but we do want to note our sample size here, which is 9. This will be important later. Okay, so what we're going to do is something called descriptive statistics. We're going to run analysis on this data, and we're going to concentrate on these two columns here that show us plant height for the white morph and the purple morph under treatment 1, which was no competition, right? And this is going to take into account all of the variation across the different data points, and it's going to be able to show us, is there really a difference between plant height of the white morph and plant height of the purple morph, and by proxy, whether or not there is a difference in reproductive success. And so in order to do that, we need to get the mean, standard deviation, and standard error of each of these columns. So I'm going to show you how to do that in Excel. It's possible to do this on Google Sheets, but Excel is free to all of you, and I encourage you to download it and learn how to use it as it is the standard. Now, for the mean, we can use the built-in formulas that Excel has. So what we're going to do is type in the formula for the mean or the average, and we could do that by typing in the equal sign and then average, and I don't even have to completely finish typing the word before this menu pops up. And we're going to double click average here, and the formula pops in. Now, there's a parentheses here, and this is where we put in our data. Now, the way Excel is laid out is kind of like a times table or a battleship map, if you've ever played that game. It has these lettered columns here, so we want the data from column C, and then it also has numbered rows. And so we want to start at C3 and end at C11. So I could type that in, but there's actually a much easier way to do it. All I have to do is click down on C3, hold it, drag it all the way down to C11, and it pops it in for you. Then I just close the formula with the parentheses and click enter. And voila, it's created the mean for me. Now, at this point, I could type in the formula for each and every one of these columns, but I don't have to, because once again, Excel is going to make it easy for us. So there's a little dark square here in the bottom right corner, and I just want to select that. You could see that the cursor has transformed into a crosshairs, and I just drag that across, and voila, it has filled in all of the means for me. Now, standard deviation, same thing. We're going to fill in the formula for standard deviation that's available on Excel. So that's equal sign and then STDEV. And we just want this one that says STDEV. We're going to double click that and the parentheses pops up. And once again, we want to highlight C3 through C11, close it with the parentheses. And you can always double check down here where it'll say C3:C11. Click enter. And that's your standard deviation. And once again, we'll just drag it across and fill them all in. Now, the standard error. Excel doesn't have a built-in formula for standard error, but it's really simple. All standard error is your standard deviation divided by the square root of your sample size. Now, at the beginning of this video, we mentioned that our sample size is 9. So we can go ahead and start the formula by typing the equal sign, and then you just have to click on your standard deviation for it to plug it in. And we're going to do forward slash for the division line. And then we're going to need the square root of our sample size. Now, our sample size is 9, and it's very easy to get the square root of that. It's 3. So if your sample size is a simple number like that, go ahead and just type the numeric in. But if it's not, what you can do in Excel is use the formula for square root, which is SQRT. And we'll just double click that here. It brings up the formula. Our sample size is 9. We'll type that in, close the parentheses, and click enter. And voila, it has created the standard error. Now, if your sample size is not consistent across your columns, you're going to have to adjust your formula for each of your columns. For instance, if you had 9 for the white morph, but only 8 for the purple morph, you would have to divide by the square root of 8. Otherwise, it's just business as usual, and we'll just drag it across. And it has produced all of the standard errors. Now, one thing you might have noticed at this point is we've got a lot of different numbers here, some of them with more decimals, some of them with less decimals, some that seem to go on forever. And we just want to clean that up so that it's easy to do our calculations. So we'll just go ahead and highlight all of this. Then we're going to right click and this menu will pop up and we want to select Format Cells. We click that and a window will pop up and it will display a number of tabs, but we want this menu over here where it says Category. We click Number and then specify the decimal places here, which is 3, and click OK. And it has cleaned up all of that data for us. So there you go, we have our mean, our standard deviation, and standard error. At this point, we're ready to do our t-test, but I'm gonna do a brief intermission, maybe we'll look at some cute animals, and then we'll come back. Hello again. So let's go ahead and get started with our t-test. For this, we're going to need to look at our mean and our standard deviation. The standard error you calculated is going to be used for the graphs for the homework, and we do have a video tutorial that can help you out with that. But we don't need to look at it right now, so let's ignore it. Now, remember we were looking at these first two columns here, and if we go down to the mean, we can look and compare the values. But that's not a very scientific way to look at them. We want to make sure that there is a statistical difference between the plant height of the two morphs, and if by proxy there is a difference in reproductive success. So the values for the two means are 2.956 and 4.433. Keeping these values in mind, let's look at this table and these formulas that came with your homework. This table is going to help you organize your data for each t-test that you'll do. So in this table, for the first column under treatment 1, you'll put your components of fitness. So we'll just start with plant height, and then we'll write our null hypothesis as a mathematical equation. You learned last week that the null hypothesis is basically saying there is no difference or no effect. In this case, we would write that the mean plant height for the purple morph is equal to the mean plant height for the white morph. In this case, the values would be 2.956 equals 4.433. The alternate hypothesis is saying that they are different from each other, and that is what we are trying to determine. And in this next column is the t value, which we are going to calculate in a second here. The last column is something we will discuss after our calculations. Okay, so I know this formula seems a little intimidating, but I'm sure it isn't too bad. This is the formula for the t-test. There's no need to memorize this, it's in your lab manual. Let's just look at what the different values are. The x-bars represent averages, with big R representing the white plant and little r representing the purple plant. So on the left here, we have the average height of the white plant, and on the right, we have the average height of the purple plant. Now, we just want the difference between the two averages, and it doesn't matter if you subtract a larger value from the smaller value. We're just going to take the positive value no matter what. So even if that results in a negative value, turn it into a positive value. Okay, now on the lower part of the formula, you can see that it has the standard deviations, which is how the formula takes into account all the variation in the data points. And last of all is little n here, which represents our sample size. So now let's go ahead and try plugging things in. Okay, so we have everything plugged in here. So our averages are 2.965 minus 4.433. And we are subtracting a larger number from a smaller number, but as I've said before, we want to take the positive of that, even if it results in a negative number. Now on the bottom, we are going to have our standard deviations divide by 9, which was our sample size, and take the square root of that. And then we're going to divide everything, and we end up with a t-value of 5.639. So now we have our t-value. Along with the t-value, we need to calculate one more thing, which is called the degrees of freedom. We can calculate that with this formula here on the right. In this formula, n still represents our sample size. Once again, our sample size is 9, so 9 minus 1 for both of the morphs, and then add them together, and our degrees of freedom is 16. And as we said earlier, you may have had different sample sizes for each of your columns. So if our sample size for the purple was 8 instead of 9, all you would do is plug them in just like before, but you would end up with a degrees of freedom value of 15 instead of 16. Now back to our original example. We have our t-value and our degrees of freedom. So what next? So we have this table, and it's going to help us decide if those averages are different and how confident we are in that difference. You'll notice these columns that say 90, 95, and 99% confidence, and all these numbers underneath. What we want to do is match our degrees of freedom to the number in the first column, so 16, and then take our t-value and look at the values listed. So our value is 5.639, and that is bigger than the number in the 90%, the 95%, and the 99% columns. So what this tells us is that we can be 99% confident that there is a difference in plant height. We can never be 100%, even if our number is very high. With this information, we can go back to our table and say that we reject the null. So in this column that I had you ignore earlier, we're going to put yes, we can reject the null at the 99% confidence value. Let's look at another example. So now let's say that our t-value was 1.631, a smaller value, and that our degrees of freedom is the same. You can see that this value is smaller than the 90% confidence value, so in this case we would say no, we cannot reject the null. Now you have the tools to do this for each of your components of fitness, for each treatment, and then answer the questions in your lab homework. However, I would like to show you one more way to calculate t-tests. I explained to you how to manually calculate these things and how the formula works, because there is value into understanding what these calculations mean and how to do them. However, I'm going to show you a faster way to do this, which is to use an online calculator. And we're going to go to this site called Usable Stats, and we're going to select Two Sample T-Test. It should bring this up, and all you have to do is plug in your raw data, click Submit, and it will do everything for you. Even isolates your sample size, your mean, your standard deviation, standard error. And then, down here, it gives you the t-statistic, or the t-value. And you can use that to go through the table. This method should save you some time, and it's just another way to do it. That's it for this video. If you have any questions, please ask your TA. Remember to check out our video tutorial for the error bars as well. And thank you very much to True Randall for producing our theme music.